Heritage Media presents the greatest of vintage artists in classic dramas from Scottish and English literature. Here is the legendary Alec Guinness, starring in The Man Who Could Work Miracles, adapted from the original tale by H.G. Wells.
This is Ralph Richardson. From time to time, I'm inviting some of my friends from the theatre to join me as my guests in this program. And today, I'm very happy to welcome Alec Guinness. He has chosen to appear in a role created by the late H.G. Wells. Well, here then is Alec Guinness, both as your storyteller and as Fotheringay in H.G. Wells' The Man Who Could Work Miracles.
I must admit this is a most unusual story. In some ways, perhaps you'll find it rather hard to believe, but I can only retell it you as the author told it to me. And I can hardly suppose that he would have made the whole thing up in his head, he being one of my parishioners at the time. The hero of the story, I think we shall have to call him our hero, was a clerk at Gomshott's the drapery store, and his name was George McWhirter Fotheringay, not the sort of name I personally should have associated with a gift such as he possessed. I remember the fellow perfectly well. He was greatly addicted to assertive argument. And it all began with an argument in the bar of our local hostelry, the Long Dragon.
Thanks, I don't mind if I do.
Same again, Miss Maybridge, and half a pint of wallop for our new friend here.
Oh, tar.
Oh, then, where was I?
Well, you were talking about miracles.
Oh, that's right. Now, look here, Mr. Beamish. Before we go any further, let's clearly understand what a miracle is. The way I look at it, a miracle is something contrary-wise to the course of nature, done by the power of will. If you like, something that couldn't happen without being especially willed.
Oh, so you say.
Well, isn't it? What do you say, sir? Am I right? A miracle is something contrary-wise to the course of nature, done by the power of will.
Well, yes, I suppose it is.
No, you can't deny that, Mr. Beamish.
Well, no, not so far as it goes.
Very well. Now, let's take a common instance. What we have here is swinging from the ceiling a paraffin lamp, or perhaps I should say a kerosene lamp. Right. Either way, we can agree to call it an oil lamp. Is that right?
Yes, that's right. Yes.
Well, now, let me show you what I mean by a miracle. That oil lamp, in the course of nature, couldn't turn upside down and keep on burning, could it?
Oh, you say it couldn't.
Well, could it? Never mind what I say. What do you say?
No, it couldn't.
Of course it couldn't. If the lamp turned upside down, it would go out in the course of nature. Any oil lamp would. Very well, then. Here comes someone, as it might be me, and stands, as it might be here, and says to that lamp, as I might do, collecting all my willpower, lamp, turn upside down in mid-air, without breaking, and go on burning steady.
How is this going to fall?
I can't keep it up, my willpower, any longer.
George Fotheringay, you ought to be ashamed. What do you think you're playing at, coming in here and playing tricks like that? This is a respectable house, and we don't want anything like that in it. Conjuring tricks.
Yeah, you silly fool. Might have set the old place alight.
Everyone accused Fotheringay of a silly trick and blamed him for causing a disturbance. They said it was nothing to be proud of, and despite his perplexity, he was rather inclined to agree with them. In fact, he was virtually asked to leave the premises, which he did. As he went home, he nervously watched the street lamps as he passed them. And it was only when he found himself sitting in his little bedroom in Church Row that he was able to grapple seriously with his memories of the occurrence. What on earth happened? I didn't want the confounded lamp upset. I'd have been burnt myself. Well, I wonder if I can do it again.
That candle on the dressing table. I wonder. Candle? Rise up in the air.
Oh! Good Lord, it did happen.
Let me be in bed.
Not with my clothes on. I mean, in bed undressed. I mean, in my pajamas. That's better. With a hot water bottle. Let me be fast asleep. Fotheringay awoke at his usual hour and was pensive all through breakfast time, wondering whether his overnight experience might not have been a particularly vivid dream. At length, just to make sure, he turned again to cautious experiments. For instance, in addition to the 2 boiled eggs that his landlady served him, he also indulged in a delicious goose egg, laid, boiled, and served by his own volition. At last he hurried off to work at Gomshott's, the draper's, where he was employed as a clerk in the counting house.
Really, I don't know which to have. And you're not helping in the least.
The blue would make up very nicely, madam.
The blue? Oh, don't be ridiculous. I wouldn't dream of being seen in the blue. Wouldn't dream of it. Even the brown is better than the blue. I don't like the stripes. Have you nothing else at all?
Only the 14 that I've shown you, madam.
14? Oh, don't be impertinent. I don't like any of them. Well, young man, don't you stand there as well. Show me some bombazines.
Are you sure none of these to your fancy, madam? The latest shades, I assure you.
Of course they're not to my fancy. Take them away.
I should like you to take the blue, madam.
The blue. Oh, but of course I've set my heart on it.
But she just
said... The madam will have the blue, Mr. Robinson. A man who could work miracles was obviously in a very advantageous position for self-advancement. But like everything else, the exercise of that gift called for a certain amount of practice. It called for caution and watchfulness. And it was in order to rehearse a few miracles in private that took George Fotheringay out that night down the quiet lane behind the gasworks. Now, what was that miracle that Moses did? Turned a stick into a snake. Well, that won't do. Not in the dark. Might get bitten. What was it happened to that stick in Tannhäuser? Turned into a rose bush. The dry wood blossomed. All right, that can't do any harm. Walking stick, blossom. Very nice. Beautiful scent. Well, rose bush, go back.
Oh, it's gone.
Oh!
Oh, dear. It must have gone back there. Sounds as if someone's been...
Who do you think you're throwing brambles at, you fool? You might have blinded me. What do you mean by it? Assaulting an officer of the law?
Well, I'm very sorry, but the fact is that I...
Oh, it's you, is it? Young fellow, what was causing trouble last night at the Long Dragon? Gent, what broke the lamp?
Well, I really didn't mean to...
Throwing brambles at a policeman on duty is an offence punishable at law. I'll be troubling you for your name and address, young man.
I'll go to Hades. It really is a very powerful gift. I didn't mean the poor man any harm. I wonder what Hades is like.
Hello,
after what had happened to Police Constable Winch, I'm glad to say that Fotheringay performed no further miracles all that week. Though I should have been happy to have numbered him among my own flock, George Fotheringay was a nonconformist. He was a regular chapel-goer, and the following Sunday evening found him in chapel as usual. It was there that he heard a sermon which made a profound impression on him. It was delivered by Mr. Maydig, the lay preacher.
What shall it profit a man if he gain the whole world and lose his own soul? It's not lawful for us to take upon ourselves those acts which are not in man's normal power to effect. And whoso makes his bargain with Mephistopheles, that good may accrue from it to himself, shall find in the fullness of time that the price must be paid in full. Therefore I say unto you, my brethren...
The tenor of that sermon threw an entirely new light on the gifts which Fotheringay had developed, and he decided to consult Mr. Maydig immediately after the service. It was in Mr. Maydig's study that he finally unburdened himself.
I can only say that I didn't make such a pact with anybody. This ability to perform miracles, it just happened. I found I could perform them.
Well, of course, in a way.
You don't believe, I suppose, that some common sort of person like myself, as it might be sitting here now, might have some sort of a twist inside him that made him able to do things just by willpower.
It's possible. Something of the sort, perhaps, is possible.
If I might make free with something here, I think I might show you by a sort of experiment. Take that tobacco jar on the table, for instance. What I want to know is whether what I'm going to do with it is a miracle or not. Just half a minute, Mr. Maydig, please. Tobacco jar, be a bowl of violets.
Good heavens! It is a bowl of violets. Yes, violets in November. How did you do that?
Oh, I just told it. There you are. That's what I mean. Is that a miracle? Or is it black art? Or what is it? And what do you think's the matter with me? I can't help it.
Quite extraordinary.
You see? Anything. A bowl of flowers if I want it. But your pipe's empty. Be a tobacco jar again.
While Mr. Maydig gingerly picked up the jar and refilled his pipe, George Fotheringay told him the whole story, beginning with the affair of the lamp in the Long Dragon and complicated by persistent allusions to the missing police constable Winch. As he went on, the transient pride Mr. Maydig's consternation had caused passed away. He became a simple man in search of advice. And as he listened, Mr. Maydig's demeanor also changed.
It's possible, it's credible. It's amazing, of course, but it reconciles a number of difficulties. The power to work miracles is a gift, a peculiar quality like genius or second sight. Hitherto it has come very rarely and to exceptional people, but in this case, I've always wondered at the miracles of Mohammed and at Yogi's miracles and the miracles of Madame Blavatsky, but of course, yes, it's simply a gift.
Well, it's PC Winch that worries me most.
Winch will have to wait. This is a most important moment. We really must test your powers to the full.
Well, name anything that you want me to do.
It requires careful thought, a very careful thought. We mustn't allow ourselves to rush into anything. You'll stay for supper, of course.
Well, that's fair. There's only one thing that worries me. What are we going to do about poor old PC Winch?
Winch will have to wait. There's a great deal more to be tended to first.
Well, anything you say. Some more burgundy.
Thank you.
More burgundy. The same.
Your health, sir. I've been very much concerned of late by the increase in the number of cases of drunkenness in the district. The man in the street, I notice, is apt to drink, not wisely, but too well. Could you do something about it?
Of course. Present company accepted. No more drinking in this town of intoxicating liquors.
Thank you. And now, if you'll come round the town with me, I really think there should be much we can usefully do.
Thank you.
hours found them in the market square under the still moon in a sort of ecstasy of thaumaturgy. They had replanned the railway, improved the roads, put a bell tower on the town hall more in accordance with its dignity. They were just going on to see what could be done about the injured pier at Southbridge when it struck 3 o'clock on the new bell tower.
3 o'clock? Oh, good Lord, I must be getting back. I've got to be up at work at 8 o'clock.
But we're only just beginning. Think of all the good we're doing. In any case, there's no hurry. Remember Joshua.
Joshua?
Stop the moon in its course. Arrest time.
Oh, that's a bit tall, isn't it?
Why not? Of course, the moon won't stop. You'll have to stop the rotation of the Earth, which will put a stop to time. Till we finish what we're doing.
Will it be all right?
Of course it will. And just think how much better everything will be in the morning.
Well, if you say so. World, just stop rotating.
Oh dear, I thought something would go wrong. Maydig, Maydig, where are you? There's been an earthquake or something terrible. Maydig, Maydig.
Perhaps I should explain what had happened. There hadn't been an earthquake in the ordinary sense of the word, but as the earth rotates so fast that the surface is travelling anything up to 1,000 miles an hour, when George Fotheringay stopped it like that, everything on the earth's surface was jerked forward more violently than if it had been fired from a cannon. Every human being, every house, every tree, all the world as we know it, had been destroyed. Luckily, with the sole exception of George Fotheringay. Well, there was only one thing for him to do.
Dear, I wish I'd never started all this. Well, I'll see what I can do. World, let me be back before ever the miracles began. Let everything be just as it was before the lamp turned upside down. Back in the Long Dragon, last Tuesday night.
Very well, then. Here comes someone, as it might be me, and stands, as it might be here, and says to the lamp, as I might do, collecting all my willpower, lamp, turn upside down in mid-air without breaking and go on burning steady.
And precisely nothing happened. Well, as I said, it's a rather improbable story. But I can't think the author can have been pulling my leg out of respect for my cloth. After all, he was one of my parishioners.
This classic drama, starring Alec Guinness and with a supporting cast that includes Patrick Allen, Denise Breyer, Olive Gregg, David Jacobs and Robert Rietti, has been a Heritage Media production. Heritage Media is part of the Divine Art Group.